Rhapsody in Blue definitely broke the rules.
It changed the way classical music was heard in America.
I mean, it's an amazing piece to play. It's really colourful, it's really bright and atmospheric.
Like, it strikes a chord with so many people.
It's incredibly important in every aspect of its writing.
It is one of the masterpieces of American music. It's iconic.
Today, with the help of the BBC Scottish Symphony Orchestra, we're going to be exploring a masterwork of the symphonic repertoire. Talking to the musicians, we'll find out just what it's like to play before being treated to an exclusive live performance.
George Gershwin's electrifying masterpiece, Rhapsody in Blue, is a landmark in 20th century music. For the first time, a symphonic piece written for the concert hall would have an unequivocally American stamp on it. Gershwin was a young man determined to prove himself as a serious composer beyond Broadway and popular song, where he'd already enjoyed considerable success. And as the blue in the title suggests, the piece would be unashamedly informed by the jazz music that was shaking up things in 1920s New York City.
Living in Harlem, the epicenter of New York jazz, with famous venues like the Cotton Club on his doorstep, Gershwin was surrounded by the hottest new sounds in the city. Exotic harmonies and dance rhythms that drew in the crowds, even if they divided the critics. With one asking, does jazz put the sin in syncopation?
Rhapsody in Blue isn't just jazz-like in the way it sounds. It's jazz-like in the way it was made. It was written in such a hurry that Gershwin didn't actually notate all of the piano writing. He played a piano part in the first performance and improvised a lot of it. And that's not the only degree of improvisation that was there. The clarinet player, Ross Gorman, introduced the famous glissando that opens the piece. That wasn't how it was written, but that's how Ross Gorman played it. Gershwin heard it and went, I'm keeping that. Apart from Beethoven's Fifth, I can't think of a more well-known opening to a piece of music. If you've ever heard Rhapsody in Blue, you know that.
That's the bit of clarinet that everybody, Jew public in the street, anyone will know.
Is it ever possible to hear how Gershwin originally wrote it?
I don't even know how it's written. Great ideas sometimes come from not thinking about it too much and just having fun with things. There are lots of versions, and some of them are very kind of gets on with it very quickly, like not making a big deal out of it. And some of the recordings, people are just milking it for all it's worth.
Do you think it's your responsibility to set the tone for the rest of the orchestra in this piece?
I don't think I would be as arrogant as thinking that. No, I mean, it's the bit that everybody's waiting for. And I'm not saying that because I'm a clarinet player, but everybody is. And even like my colleagues, and they say, oh yeah, looking forward to doing Rhapsody in Blue, and I love that solo, that's great. And so yeah, that's lovely, but thanks.
Let's do the opening.
The nervousness and the adrenaline pumping is what very often makes you play better. So it's whether sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work.
Pressure,
no pressure. At all, just enjoy and relax.
We should appreciate this is really difficult.
Yes, of course.
It's exciting. You want to make it exciting and cool and not too square. I studied classical music and I play classical music. You want to sound a bit cooler than that. I think what is really cool is the arrival and when the orchestra or part of the orchestra is coming in, is kind of
Yeah.
It feels like an elastic band, like those things you do for physio. Kind of stretch, 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 and relax. It feels a bit like that. It's quite, it's quite fun.
So physically and technically, what's happening in a glissando?
Well, there are many, many, many ways to do it.
But essentially, you're sliding?
Yeah, well, there's three registers of the instrument. The bottom register, and it's not very fit for glissando because it's too low, basically. And then there's the kind of that area which is a bit rubbish on the clarinet. And then we go to the higher register, which is basically all the fingers back on. Mm-hmm. And then because we're working higher, it's much easier. Because even if you could do a glissando at the bottom register, there would be the problem of... And when we get here, the next note is that, full on. And well, there's no way you can do a glissando that because of this kind of...
Yeah.
One technique is to do with fingers. Just with fingers, lifting the fingers away from the hole slowly to...
Lovely.
As fingers. But I don't like that. It's because I find it's too dodgy. It's too tricky. Everything can go wrong. And what I do, and again, this is coming from mucking about as a kid with my clarinet, having fun with it. It's a bit geeky, but there you are. I drop everything in my throat and all that to flatten the note. So if I were talking about the arrival note, the concert B flat, C for us, I can go about a fourth down from that note. Okay. So that's, for me, that's the base of my glissando.
And that's without moving your fingers, this is just in the throat.
Here. And then it's kind of mixing real notes, going up and then dropping that without being heard too much. And then you have the possibility of timing, depending on conductors, to know where she wants you to arrive. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of... If the conductor wants to milk it, I can milk it.
Although his musical genius is undeniable to us today, Gershwin wasn't your typical child prodigy.
His musical upbringing is unconventional. He's not interested in music at all until he's 10. He had a violinist friend who he heard play. He became rather obsessed. He then learned the piano.
He taught himself by copying the many different types of music he was hearing on the streets of his native Manhattan. His family wasn't aware of this until one day a piano appeared at home, which was supposed to be a gift for his older brother, Ira.
George sat down and played the piano at once, and we were all flabbergasted and didn't realize that he'd been playing in other places. And it really was bought for Ira. But when Ira heard George, he gave up at once. And my brother Arthur was supposed to play the violin, but he found, he wondered why he had to stand and play an instrument and not sit the way George does, you see.
He absorbs music around him, and clearly it flowed out of him.
Oh, he was a fabulous pianist himself. I mean, when he got into a party, he'd be attracted to the piano like a magnet. And at the slightest provocation, he would just go to the instrument and just entertain everybody and just celebrate the art of music. You know, it's...
Can you relate to that showman in him?
No. When I'm in a party, if there's a piano there, it's just about the last thing I want to do.
Eventually, his parents decided more formal piano lessons were in order, and by his teens, he'd left school early to become a song plugger in Tin Pan Alley. Soon, though, he started writing his own songs.
Gershwin starts out as a songwriter. He writes his first published song when he's about 17. He has lots of hits on Broadway. You know, I'll Build a Stairway to Paradise is from 1922, which is 2 years before Rhapsody in Blue. He's very, very successful.
Is Clark and McCullough here yet?
Nope, they're not here.
Those fellows are always late. Tell you what we do. While we're waiting for them, let's take the girls and the buck dance and strike up the band.
Good.
All right, girls, come on.
His first big seller was Swanee, which appeared in a show in 1919. Al Jolson liked it, recorded it,
and it earned him $10,000 for a year's worth of sales. $10,000 in 1920 is approximately $126,000 in contemporary money. That is money with a capital M.
I've been away from you a long time.
To say he was merely a songwriter, I think, is to misunderstand what he was doing in those songs, even in his very early songs. They are not run-of-the-mill, silly little tunes for silly little musicals. Most musicals in those days were abidingly silly. That was their raison d'etre. They were there merely as entertainment. They were not there for depth. What you get with Gershwin songs, however, is musical depth. You get unexpected melodies that don't go quite where you think they're going to go, and you get really unexpected harmonies, which are absolutely not the standard four-square thing.
After the clarinet's bold announcement of Gershwin's intentions to do something different, it swiftly falls to the piano soloist to remind us that Gershwin's inspiration for the piece came from the novel new harmonies sweeping across New York City.
In that opening piano riff, what are the indications that this is a jazz piece?
Well, it's a particular mode of jazz, you know, what we call blue note, you know, right away he uses a scale that is not a traditional scale, so that's the color that is needed for jazz.
With Rhapsody in Blue, Gershwin created a work that has become a staple in the repertoire for both classical and jazz pianists.
I'm sure if you speak to any pianist, they say it's a real milestone for them, and certainly in terms of where it takes the orchestra, how it explores, how differently we can play and accompany and interact. It's certainly incredibly important in every aspect of its writing.
Gershwin comes to the music from improvisation. His starting point is sitting at the piano. That's his. That's where he surely felt at home and at one with the music, and it develops from there.
If you take a portion like Hero, if you take something like that, the harmonic sensibility of it really lends itself to improvisation. So when you get to the B-flat 7 and you're descending, you can improvise. So for me, I get there after all those movements and I just, you know. And then it lends itself, you know, you're back there, etc. So, you know, you can get back into the piece. It lends itself.
In fact, Gershwin himself improvised the piano part for Rhapsody in Blue's premiere.
This first performance, I know there were a few portions that didn't have any piano part written into the score.
I would love to know actually what Gershwin did, whether these improvisations were close to what actually came to be written. You know, that's one instance in music history where I would have loved to have a time machine and go back there. I always wonder when I'm playing these and how different could it have been? It's a little bit difficult to notate improvisations, of course. He did his best in notating a piece that would be played the same way each time, or at least with the same notes, and still give the feeling of extemporization. And I think in performance, it is your responsibility to impart as much freedom as you can to make it feel like an improvisation, like it just never existed before and it's made up on the spot.
think you can improvise in a smart way that works stylistically with the piece, and that doesn't just mean you're going off on one. I think it's similar to how a classical pianist might approach a cadenza.
Are you able to explain to us or give us a little bit of insight how you do that?
I think I tend to be inspired or influenced by the various conditions between one venue and another. A different piano, a different acoustic, a different orchestra, a different hall, a different public will all contribute to making me do things differently each time. I've never learned to improvise. I mean, I do it in my own sort of limited way. I've improvised cadenzas for Mozart concerti, for example, but only the slow movement ones. I'm not quick enough to improvise, you know, main movements. What I can say, though, is that I don't necessarily think of it in pianistic terms, but I try to impart a vocal quality to it. You know, blues singers, you know, and I try to imagine. Just a line like this. Beyond that, I really, really can't explain what happens because it just has to happen.
Rhapsody is a title many composers have used for putting together typically folk music material in some kind of sequence to make a beautiful and exciting piece. Liszt did it, and many, many composers in the Romantic period particularly did this. I think in terms of concertos, what is striking with Rhapsody in Blue is that the piano is very often playing completely on its own. In more classical repertoire like the Mozart and Beethoven concertos, it's not quite as heroic and outstanding, and it's more integrated as chamber music with the orchestral groups. So clearly he was experimenting a little bit with what the pianist's role could be playing with the orchestra.
Gershwin greatly admired composers like Liszt and Debussy and wanted to be taken seriously in New York's more august concert halls, with his music heard alongside the likes of Ravel and Stravinsky, modern giants adored by the critics. Rhapsody in Blue was his chance to show that he was more than just a writer of popular songs.
One of the great stories about Rhapsody in Blue is that this is the concert debut of a Broadway composer, which is a bit demeaning to everybody concerned.
At first, Gershwin hadn't taken seriously band leader Paul Whiteman's commission, but upon seeing a newspaper article announcing he was premiering a jazz concerto at a concert entitled An Experiment in Modern Music, he hurriedly got down to work.
Paul Whiteman asks him to write this piece, which he writes incredibly quickly. And if you're writing something in between 3 to 5 weeks, you're going pretty much on instinct.
It's important information for me to know that he had the idea of this piece on his journey from New York to Boston.
Where he apparently, hearing the train rhythms, conceived the piece from beginning to end in the space of an instant.
That means a very limited time on the train. He sketched out this piece in his mind.
I mean, just to be able to do that.
Just give us the slap, because here we employ a particular jazz technique. Just give us the slap, those of you with the crutches. Is it possible? I'm just thinking, being a chairs myself. Can you slap it like the basses do? Yep, just do it like that. Very. That's the sound. That's the sound. That's the sound. And before we put the trumpet melody, let's have everybody else doing this Latin style rhythm on top of the slapping, with the slapping.
The rhythms are always changing, and he has this kind of train, chicka 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 idea.
So this is probably the train going here with the slapping. But on top of that, there's a melody. Just go with us, trumpets and turn it for that wild streak.
And it wasn't just public transport that was giving Gershwin inspiration. He'd spent his time steeped in the sounds and dance rhythms of the jazz age and was now ready to incorporate them into a more conventional classical work.
Gershwin uses traditional rhythms, you know, like 4-4 time and 2-4 time. So it's that's very normal, but within that, there are syncopations and accentuations against the beat or off the beat, which, of course, form the typical jazz style.
Syncopations, ragtime, Cuban clave rhythms and so on, and Charleston kind of effects, they come out because of the articulation. Da, 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 you know, this kind of idea. Just to maybe to project a little bit more where he wanted the rhythm to be different.
Of course, it's a particular kind of jazz music. It's the jazz band music of the 1920s. And it's not swing. It is white man's jazz.
Normally you don't. But it...
Well, now you're talking.
Yeah. So that treatment of rhythm, you know, really pervades the whole piece.
With just a few weeks until the concert, Gershwin quickly composed a score for two pianos. Not yet adept at orchestration, he employed the help of popular pianist and arranger Ferdig Rofe to write the parts.
The version that everybody knows is orchestrated by Ferdig Rofe. That said, Gershwin was not a man who was backward in coming forward. If he hadn't liked what Grofe did, I'm sure he would have insisted that it be changed.
There are so many wonderful individual parts, but certainly as a string player, you get to sit out quite a lot and just enjoy it. So you've got the fantastic pianist right on your right-hand side and then other instrumentalists, and you just feel totally absorbed by it. And so much of our repertoire is us playing constantly. But to actually sit back and almost be an audience member for many parts of it is really thrilling. To try not to just beam all the way through because there's this amazing piano sound and then amazing this, amazing that. And, you know, I feel like, oh, no, I'm actually on stage. I probably shouldn't look like I'm enjoying it quite as much as I am.
And getting paid for it.
And getting paid, exactly. I have a solo in the lyrical section and I play with our principal oboe in unison. So that's always a challenge in the orchestra because of the distances. So if I play with a pianist who's right next door to me, that's more natural. But to try and make contact from afar is one of the challenges. So it's a lyrical on the top string, the E string of the violin. And then it falls down. And then it's my job to bring the orchestra back. So it's a kind of dreamy world, and then together with the oboes, we invite the orchestra to come back and join us.
Welled up listening to you play that. How beautiful is it for you to play?
Oh gosh, well there's plenty of times when I don't make beautiful sounds at all. That can make me well up for all sorts of different reasons. I think it's always a balance as a performer because you're incredibly involved in the music and you want to be emotional. It's our job to try and portray those emotions, but to a certain extent you have to keep it in check to be able to do it efficiently and well. So something like that is relatively straightforward for me to play, so I can be quite in the moment. Mm-hmm.
Bravo, 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 bravo. I think in Gershwin's time, this was called the Tchaikovsky theme. It has this singing poetry, but I think always in this place of Copeland, there's something about the American optimism, this that is striving upwards towards something, the future.
From strumming strings to syncopated rhythms, for the first time a conventional orchestra was being asked to employ new styles and cutting-edge instrumental techniques to bring Gershwin's ideas to life.
Mark, what are some of the more unusual effects that Gershwin employs in this piece that you might not find in normal symphonic writing?
Yeah, well, I suppose straight off you could go for the idea of having a wah-wah mute, or a Harmon mute, as it's called, but a wah-wah effect would have been used maybe in the 20s, especially maybe Duke Ellington's band used it for a kind of a crying effect. That kind of, almost kind of jungle kind of sounds, if you like, that Duke Ellington would have used later in the 20s. Mm-hmm. But Gershwin was using it in 1924, so it was quite maybe cutting edge.
And what does that bring to the piece, that sound?
I suppose that crying element, or that kind of longing element, perhaps, or harking back to the past, perhaps, or even looking to the future. He was always trying to do something new, I think.
Rhapsody in Blue premiered on the afternoon of the 12th of February 1924 at New York's Aeolian Hall in a sold-out concert entitled An Experiment in Modern Music. The concert was billed as an educational event designed to showcase jazz as a serious and sophisticated art form that could and should be played in the concert hall.
Tchaikovsky was there.
Rachmaninoff was there.
John Philip Sousa was there.
Willie the Lion Smith was there, the great jazz musician.
And Stravinsky also. I mean, there must have been a lot of pressure on him.
It broke convention because it was a very exciting time for popular music, with jazz, you know, particularly coming from the African-American community, and how you could reconcile the way society behaved at that time, the sound of it completely being dismissed if it was played by black people. But then when Mr. George Gershwin comes along and plays it, they're like, ooh, I love this.
I think more the style was a shock to the culture, that actually we could play that kind of music in a hall with a serious audience and people would enjoy it.
Not all the critics liked it, apparently. Something like 20 of the critics thought it was tripe.
It polarized the music world. There were people who hated it.
That was a big stone thrown into a very quiet lake, that kind of music. I mean, it was quite cool, but I think it was still seen as Negro music.
I have thought about whether he could be accused of cultural appropriation, but I don't think George Gershwin ever hid the fact of where it came from. I think one of the things that people in the black and African-American community understand is that at that time, the attention for a black composer was non-existent. You could have been George Gershwin and black, and you would have been ignored. So I think there are two things here. He writes on such an incredibly high level. He was incredibly successful, and he made no bones about where it came from. And he respected the community.
It was played 86 times within a year by Paul Whiteman. That's an extraordinary thing. These days, trying to get a second performance of a world premiere is really difficult, let alone 86.
But the world was just crazy and desperate for something happy. They wanted to see something light and funny and laugh for a couple of hours and then go back to doom and gloom.
It just took on its own life. It just enlivened the repertoire.
To begin, we're going to play a work for which we've had more requests than any other one, George Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue.
I think for a long time he didn't really mix with the like of Ravel or Debussy and all that, even though it was gorgeous and beautiful. It was more considered as serious music.
But it's stood the test of time, hasn't it?
Ever since the Rhapsody was premiered in 1924, it's been a staple in the repertoire, and its vitality and its energy and its beautiful tunes defy classification.
Having originally been orchestrated for Paul Whiteman's jazz band, Rhapsody in Blue incorporates instruments it's highly unusual to see in a traditional symphony orchestra.
We're so used to hearing orchestras play in a certain way, and what's so wonderful about having these extra added instruments, the banjo, the saxophones, it just shows that with just a little inflection of different colour, it can make us all play in a completely different way.
Are there indications on the page that this was originally orchestrated for a jazz orchestra?
Yeah, I guess in the way that the saxophones are written, the way that we play together and the kind of phrasings that are marked, that kind of is indicative of the kind of thing that you would find in a big band of that period. And also the other instruments in the orchestra, like the banjo that we bring in, and that which gives a kind of a certain rhythm to the proceedings that is unusual in symphonic kind of orchestration.
So, Malcolm, you're very much in charge of the rhythm section, are you?
Yes, I suppose so. That's one of my main roles in here, and it's just providing that rhythmic function, which is like a jazz band from that kind of era. So it's very much a kind of rhythmic four in the bar kind of... that kind of thing where you're kind of really giving that rhythmic drive to the music, yeah.
How rare is it to have a banjo in a symphonic work?
I would say... fairly rare, yeah. I think there are some other pieces, but off the top of my head...
Porgy and Bess, is there a banjo in that?
I've never done that. I would like to do that.
If you've not done it, there can't be a banjo in it.
Is there anything unique or specific about the voicing of the sax for a piece like this?
Yeah, I mean, it is harmonised in a very much a jazz way, isn't it, in that, with the kind of close harmonies often, yeah.
Can we hear you harmonise?
OK.
Those chords are just gorgeous.
It's really fun to play. When we have a section like this, the spotlight's kind of on us. And so we have to kind of, you know, take in consideration the fact that it's a 1920s, 1930s kind of idea and play some crazy vibrato and really try and blend in with each other as you would do in a dance band.
I mean, definitely we play in a much more controlled way when we're in a symphony orchestra than we might in a big band or something like that. It's also to do with volume and attacks, isn't it? So we need to be much more precise in our articulation and also our intonation, and we need to be able to get out of the way as well, because often they don't want to hear lots of saxophone, you know, so we need to be able to pull the sound back as well when required.
As musicians, just looking at this as a piece of music, what for you are the keys to its success?
I think it's really unique in the way that it pulls together lots of influences. So there's the jazz influence, there's a classical influence, there's even Latin music in there. There's obviously music from, I mean, jazz is from the African-American tradition. So it successfully pulls them all together without really having them in bits. You know, it's kind of a unified whole as a piece. And the themes are very strong, but then they're dealt with in a very intelligent way. So it has its own sound to its own world that it creates. It's not bits of this and bits of that. It's very, very cleverly done.
Fascinating river. Fascinating river.
Whether you're a novelist, a playwright, or a composer, the thing that gets you remembered is your voice. What endures is individuality, and that's what Gershwin has.
Can you hear references of his other work in this piece?
Well, yes. I mean, there is a little bit of melodic kernel that, which is similar to
The Man I Love,
and he'll be big and strong. The man I love. And when he comes my way, I'll do my best to make him stay.
You can hear a lot of extraordinary melodies in Rhapsody in Blue. It's one of the things that makes it famous. But it's not like he's raiding his back catalogue.
And I won't understand. And in a little while, he'll take my hand.
I think he had an extraordinary melodic gift. There are classical structures in his songs, and there are song-like forms in his classical structures. It isn't that he's taking one and pushing it into the other.
Still, I'm sure to meet him one day. Maybe Tuesday will be my good news day.
I think that melody and idiosyncratic harmonies were what he specialized in, no matter what material he was writing.
I can speak as a composer. We all have our little elements of language, and we inevitably repeat ourselves. Someone like Poulenc repeated himself constantly, but he was so good, we didn't mind. We don't mind.
Just a huge joy, because it invites you to be in the moment, and that's the most important thing we can be as musicians.
In recent years, I've really grown very close to this piece. It just gets a little better and better each time as I get to know it more. Even though, you know, my acquaintance with it has been for almost all my life.
Everyone says to me, oh, you play this all the time. I haven't played it since I was in a youth orchestra, so I haven't played it for 25 years, or nearly 30 years now. For me, it feels so fresh and so new, and I would imagine for people that have even played it many, many times, that's the case.
It's really colourful, it's really bright and atmospheric. I was thinking about the opposite of Rhapsody in Blue in the American sense might be Copland's Quiet City, perhaps, if the quiet New York City twilight, perhaps, where the city kind of goes to sleep, and then Rhapsody in Blue is a complete opposite, metropolitan kind of madness.
There's a reason why this is such a loved piece of American music, and indeed not just loved in America, but loved worldwide, because it is so rich and so strong and so idiosyncratic. You listen to that and it doesn't sound like anybody else.
I think this tune was an inspiration for many composers reaching for something song-like in America.
He created a sound that is uniquely American, and the sound that is uniquely American is completely entwined in jazz.
American sound has to do with a certain kind of optimism, mm-hmm. something positive. And I think for me, the essence of it is in the slow theme, where I see the plains of America in my view. There's this upwards movement which has a sense of hope.
This is the sound of the African-American experience in America when it's, you know, mixed together in a cosmopolitan way, trying to find its way through. And I think George Gershwin liberated that sound, you know, for all to hear and for all to recognize, because nobody denies where it comes from. So, you know, it's a wonderful coming together of America, I think.
The way the piece ends, there's something very Hollywood and Broadway about it. Do you think it's a little wink from Gershwin?
I find it more elevating than sort of winking.
Yes, yeah.
You have at the beginning. And then he simply slows it down and sort of glorifies this little kernel, you know, and it's meant to be elevating.
you, how important is this piece of music as a part of 20th century music?
It's one of the absolute top.
It's really thrilling.
It's worked and stood the test of time for, gosh, almost a century now.
That's as good as it gets.
I think George Gershwin's legacy in this piece in particular is that it recognizes that there are many people that make up a society, and this is the best of it. This is what it can sound like.
I think I will merely say that I can't imagine being without it.
So, without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, this is George Gershwin's Rhapsody in Blue.
Thank you.
That's the best, I think.
Yeah, that's great.
Great. Thank you. Bravo!
Bravo, everybody. Bravo, everybody.